Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this interview with Michael. Now, Michael, I've gone and kind of promoted your channel before because you do videos and courses on specifically Arduino. And just out of interest, before we get into the actual videos and the courses and what you do, just tell us a little bit of your background, how you got into electronics, did you study it, and kind of what's your full-time job at the moment?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, first I want to say, Martin, thank you so much for having me on your channel. It's pretty exciting because I do like your channel a lot, and I can see from the comments that a lot of people love your channel. So just thanks a lot for having me. I really appreciate that.
Thank you.
So, you know, I actually got into electronics about 10 years ago, but as far as like Arduino goes, my interest there almost started with the programming side, because if you've gotten into Arduino, Annie, you know that it's not just hardware, it's also programming. It's like that fusion where hardware and programming meet. So it's like you have to know a little bit of both, and then that's really enough to make it work good. So my programming started back when I was in college, about 15 years ago.
Okay.
And I was studying neuroscience in college, and I got a chance to be in this mathematical and biosciences institute over the summer. It was like this two-week, almost like mini conference, and they brought in all these awesome people from around the country to talk, but then they also brought in students from around the country from different universities and from like the community. So it was like, it wasn't just like college students, it was also like professors at university were part of this group.
Wow.
So I got to be a part of this, and they actually paid me to be in it. It was really exciting.
They paid
me. I know, and for a poor college student, like they're paying me to do this, it was so cool. So, and this is, I went to Ohio State University.
Okay.
And so I was in this course, and part of the course was with the other students, we had to create a simulation, a computer simulation of some type of biological system. And the conference was about simulating like biological systems.
Wow.
Basically. So anyway, the guy, we had this proctor who was part of the institute, who's kind of helping us with the software side, because I didn't know anything about software, and he had MATLAB. I don't know if you've heard of MATLAB before, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
My first introduction to programming was with MATLAB, and I would sit behind this guy, and he's just at the computer typing, and the first thing I noticed was that he never touched his mouse. Like, he would always type and use all these keyboard shortcuts, and I thought, like, man, how are you doing this? How are you doing that? And he could make the program. We were actually simulating an ant. So we made this like the simulated ant, and it was follow pheromone trails based on, you know, certain like neurostimulation, all that kind of stuff. It sounds really complicated. It really wasn't. It was kind of like a watered down version simulation. And again, it was really just for like the students in my little group to kind of wrap our heads around.
Now, I have to stop you there, because I mean, we've obviously known each other a little while now. We've had long conversations. I didn't know all this, what you started out studying. So you started studying, so it wasn't electronics, it wasn't a technical degree.
No.
It was neurosciences.
Yes.
Good Lord. Okay. And that's when this was introduced to you.
Right, the software side. Still really no hardware side. It was just,
what were you hoping to be?
I wanted to be a researcher. That was like my goal in life. I wanted to research the nervous system, the brain, you know, because I like, it just fascinates me.
Wow.
I have a family member who's got a mental illness.
Okay.
And so that's kind of what drew me into that. And then as I got, you know, I was always, as growing up, I was kind of like more of a soft sciences guy.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then, but as I got into college, I really started enjoying technical things. Like, I just couldn't get enough of like the technical side of how things were operating. And the nervous system, the brain is just so amazing, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's just so cool to learn about. And so I wanted to go, you know, finish my bachelor's and then go on to graduate school and do research. That was my goal. Yeah, but so much for that, right? You know, getting married and having to provide for a family and having like kids and kids and kids and all that type of stuff. So.
And that changed the
path. Right, it did. But I still am really interested in neuroscience. And actually I find that I really want to bring some of the stuff that I'm doing now back into the sciences, because that's you see a lot of people doing really cool stuff with Arduino in the sciences, and I just love that side
of
it.
How interesting. So what happens? So you finish college. What is your day job? Because at the moment, you do brilliant introductory courses and videos on YouTube. and then you've got paid for courses. But at the moment, this is kind of a part-time gig for you. Although it doesn't seem like it, because I mean, the quality of the work is brilliant, but so how do you sustain yourself?
Well, right now, so for a while I was working in the military. I'm still in the military, I'm in aviation stuff. Okay. I actually fly helicopters.
Okay.
And so I did that full-time for a while, but it just, I was like in aviation safety and stuff. Which isn't all, aviation safety is not that exciting of a gig. I'll have
to be heavens, okay.
So I just really wanted to transition out of that,
okay.
And kind of do things that, you know, because life is only so long, you know, it's like you want to, you know, you're here and then you're gone. It's like you want to try to do stuff that matters, I think.
Yeah.
So I wanted to follow my interests a little more. So I was able, like my wife had finished college. She was in a good paying job. So I was able to transition out of that. And so I still do the flying stuff, just not as much.
Okay.
And now I'm more into developing this course. That's really what I'm pouring a lot of my efforts
so
into right now.
How long ago did this start?
It's funny. It started about the videos online. I started doing those probably about 3 years ago. And
did you think at that point in time, was it kind of, were you seriously thinking that you wanted to develop it into something where you're going to try and earn an income or teach people? Or what was your thought as you got into it?
Well, at first I thought, I knew I wanted to generate some type of income online. I was interested in that, but I'm like, man, what, you know, how could I wasn't sure what angle to take and stuff like that. And I was already into programming. I was already into Arduino and that type of stuff. And so I started making these videos, but the quality was just horrible. I mean, like, audio just trash, and I mean everything was video was horrible.
Yeah.
And but people were still leaving really positive feedback on the videos. There's so many, like, I don't know about you, but I've met so many awesome people.
Yeah.
Around the world, never would be possible without the awesomeness of the internet. So I met, I was just so impressed with this feedback I was getting. I was like, maybe I could really step up the game a little bit and focus on a specific type of audience that I could serve. And so that's when I started getting a little more serious about, you know, I think there's an angle here where I could fill a need where people are looking for. That's kind of where I...
Brilliant.
Yeah.
So, but your videos kind of got more serious. I mean, I've looked over just recently over your videos, and you started 2-3 years ago, and then you got a fairly more serious into the production and the production quality, and then starting a course. So how much time and effort has it taken you to kind of go from kind of more casually doing it to get kind of getting the production nailed down and doing what you do?
It's time intensive, you know.
Yeah.
It has taken me easily a year to develop the course, easily a year.
Heavens.
And that doesn't include the possibly even 2 years to develop the course, you know, and the course is never done. It's kind of like any electronics products you've ever done. It's never really done. You can always add more.
Yeah.
But at some point you have to say, hey, you know, it's good. Come in, check it out, that type of thing. And so I've got it open, but I'm always trying to add stuff to it. So it is. I've put lots of time and energy into really tailoring the course.
And You've got a very different model to the way I kind of generate my income on YouTube. You've kind of used YouTube and Google as a front end with nice introductory videos to pull them into your course, which is behind a paywall. So when did you decide on that model, and how tough has it been to set up, and how successful has it been?
That's a good question. So I was, you know, it started with those crappy videos I talked about, right? And then I thought, you know what, I'd really made a lot of videos, and I call them crappy, like the content was good, it was solid, but the production wasn't there. So what I started doing is I thought, you know what, maybe, because it's like, you know, you think of Google's algorithm, it's looking for words and stuff, it doesn't necessarily categorize videos as well, you know, because I'm trying to think, like, I want to try to get this message out there, maybe I should start writing, you know, like, transcribing kind of the video. So what
yes.
I did, what I actually started is I wrote a book that kind of followed along with the videos.
Brilliant.
So the videos actually came first. I had a very clear outline of the videos I made, and so that outline turned very well into a book. And since I'd already done videos, I was intimately familiar with all of the, you know, how the the specific programs I was demonstrating worked, how the circuits worked. So I went and I wrote a book, and then I started with that book, selling it in like iTunes, and I sold it on my website. And you know, when I first started, I remember I had to pay a fee to get an ISBN, which is like a number that every book needs if you have to sell. And I had to buy 10 of them, and it was like $250. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, am I gonna be able to make that money back with this book? I don't know. And my dad at the time, he's like, geez, you can pay $250, you sure can pay it back. Well, you know, a year and a half later, and I've made thousands of dollars,
you know,
yeah, selling this book, and that's just in iTunes. But really, my so that's where the book started, and yeah, I was selling the book. But then what I started doing is integrating the videos into that, because books are awesome, but I mean, this is like the age of video.
Yeah.
And I love being able to watch a video, and it's nice to hear a voice, see what's going on, and then have the text then be a reference to that.
Brilliant.
So that's kind of how I transitioned into that whole course, and there's a lot of work to set that up.
There's a lot of work to do that. But then, so you've gone and done the book, you've got the front-end videos on YouTube, and now you've got the actual paid-for course behind a paywall. That's not straightforward to set up. So just explain a little bit about that and where the videos reside and kind of how that works.
All right, so the way I do it, and it's okay if I get like technical on how.
Yeah.
All right, so the way I do it is I have a WordPress website. So I'm sure WordPress is a really popular website software. And I have a plugin that I use that's like a subscription plugin. It manages subscriptions.
Ah, okay.
And so I can restrict specific access to certain pages on my website based on somebody's subscription status. And then that subscription software interfaces with, you know, PayPal, major credit cards, all that type of stuff, so I can accept payments that way.
Interesting. Do they take a cut? I mean, is there...
No, they don't. No. I pay for the software.
Okay.
It's a one-time payment for the software. And there's a lot of different softwares out there. Some do take cuts, some don't.
Okay.
But the one I'm using doesn't take a cut.
Heaven.
And so I've got that set up. And then behind the paywall, I host the videos, the paid videos on Vimeo.
Interesting.
Because Vimeo is pretty good. I think they're a relatively quality host. You can do HD video, and with Vimeo allows you to restrict access to certain domains. So I restrict the access of my videos to a specific domain on my website. So not only can people, I'm able to restrict that access to people who are paying for the course, right?
Brilliant.
And then inside the course, I have the, you know, all the videos that walk people through the course. People can download the book from the website, you know, as a PDF. And then they can also, I also have a forum there where for every video tutorial, there's an associated forum thread. So if they have a question about a specific video, like, hey, how does this work? Or even better yet, if they have an observation like, you know what, I did this and then I did this, and this is kind of what happened. So people kind of share their, you know, their own results there. So that's nice. And then I've got a place where people can say, hey, Mike, please make a video about this, and then they can upvote it or downvote it. So for me, it's great, because then I've got a real keyed in, like, I know if I've got, you know, 10 or more people, like, upvoting a particular topic, I know, man, I need to focus on that topic next.
Brilliant.
So, yeah.
So, I mean, we were talking even before this video. I mean, there's a lot of work that's gone into that, and
yes,
a lot of administration. I don't think people really appreciate the amount of time it takes just to set up something like that and administer it. And at the moment on YouTube are providing a paid subscription service. And I initially, when I looked at it, kind of thought, oh, is it going to be that good? Because their fees are quite high. But as you pointed out, when you work the time that it takes to administer, having your own website, getting the software up and running, the back end, Vimeo, let's say, as a hosting service, there's a lot of work there. So some of these other services actually may be a consideration as well.
Yes, because they handle a lot of that back end work. Because, and you know, I'm always in a point where I'm like considering, because I want to focus on the stuff that's going to deliver the most value to my customers. And for me, that's creating really high quality videos.
Yeah.
And taking the time to have a nice, well-written type tutorial in addition to the video, all that type of stuff. If I'm spending more time doing the administrative side, then then I'm, you know, it's like that balance, you know, I wanna, this is, and plus for me, it's way more fun making cool videos than it is doing administrative stuff. Way more fun.
Yep.
No question.
I'm with you there. So just, I've recently seen you've started getting into kind of robotic vehicles and that kind of thing. So you've got a whole host of projects. Just list some of the projects that you actually cover off and you kind of go people through. I know you go from literally, obviously setting up Arduino, getting lights, right. Fading lights.
Yeah, so the course, you know, the course is really for somebody who is, it's called the Arduino course for absolute beginners. So the idea is like you're a punk off the street, don't know jack about it, and it's like, hey, what, you know, what's Arduino, what's this? And so I take you from really having no clue about programming or electronics, digital electronics.
Brilliant.
And I kind of walk you into it really slowly. And so the thing, what I really try to focus on in almost all of my videos is covering the details that a lot of times get looked over.
Yes.
And not assuming that somebody knows something, you know, and occasionally I'll pause and I'll try to repeat something just to try to drive home a point. But to kind of go where, to get to answer your question there, at the end of every video, almost every video, I present a challenge. And so the challenge is kind of like its own little mini project. So every tutorial almost has its own little mini, it's not like a full focused project, but it takes the circuit in the software and, you know, the program behind the circuit, and it asks you to just, listen, Martin, this is what we just went over, but I want you to kind of step just a little bit further than what we did.
Yeah.
Because I want you to exercise what you just learned.
Brilliant.
So I try to do that at the end of every tutorial. And if you do those challenges, it almost sets you up for the next video. You know,
brilliant.
And that's kind of how I try to cascade it. Now, in between these tutorials and those kind of mini challenges, I have what I call a crucible. And a crucible is like more of a formal project,
okay,
that somebody puts together. And I don't really provide like, this is how you do it. I just say, look what I did. Can you do this? You know what I mean?
Yes.
That's, and I have one, I can show it to you later. One of the, if you want, or we can show it to you now, one of the crucible projects in the course.
Okay. Which one's that?
It's the slot machine.
Go grab it quickly.
All right, okay.
What is this and what made you put this together?
All right, well, again, I wanted projects for the students to be able to do, but I also wanted to do it, like a lot of times you put together an electronics project on a breadboard and it's wires everywhere. And, you know, I love that Frankensteinian breadboard look.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I think that's cool, but sometimes it's nice to feel like you've got a little more polished of a project. And either A, that adds a lot of time, or that adds a lot of money cost, you know, buying enclosures and stuff like that. So I thought, wouldn't it be cool if I could make like enclosure just out of paper that's, you know, spruces it up a little bit. It hides all of that, all the wires and all that type of stuff, but it's still kind of, you still get the effect of the circuit kind of thing. So what I did is I had, and these are an example of some of the enclosure files that you can download from the website. And it's just, you know, you cut out a certain dimension and it actually folds around your breadboard and it positions for things like potentiometers, buttons, and lights. So you can see here, in this is a slot machine, and so here you press the button here, you run the slot. So we're you went to Vegas, you know all about
this
feature. So I'll press the button, then you can see you get the roll, you know, and then it slows down, and then it selects one, and then if you win or if you don't win, there you get the X, and then it's random, so I don't know if we'll get a win or not. But if you win, it has a certain behavior too.
And does it spit out coins?
It doesn't spit out any coins. But you're going to provide the coins this time, or maybe I should provide the coins to you. Right? But yeah, so you know, and you look at this and you think, well, man, maybe this is kind of trite. It's just like LEDs and stuff. But really, if you think about what goes into programming something like this, you have to understand how the pins on an Arduino work. You have to be able to, you know, set them high, set them low. You have to be able to set up a button. You have to be able to understand timing. You have to understand the fundamentals of a for loop in programming. You have to use arrays.
Yes.
You know, and there's a lot of ways to program something, and there's no right way. But there's these fundamental concepts at the root of something like this. So even though it's just LEDs blinking, it's not so much the effect of it, but it is the all of the things that it takes to pull together. And this is really, this project alone pulls together all of the stuff that you should be learning through the course, that you are learning, and it really forces you to pull your knowledge together. You know, and so it's kind of fun because, like, you can show it to your kids, you can show it to your wife or friends, and they think, oh wow, that looks cool. You know, so that's kind of...
It's, I tell you, and especially for the person beginning, as you say, just to have an enclosure and give something form and function. And of course, the person who does this, for one, having the knowledge to have written the code and understand the code and get this, and then when they show someone else, it's like, wow, it's not just a breadboard with wires, it's like a functioning little game, if you will,
right.
Something to entertain. What a brilliant idea. And what I want to highlight as well, which is really clever, which I actually don't do enough of, is so you've decided, where did you call yourself Open Source Hardware Group?
That's correct.
So you came up with that name and you cleverly kind of use an open source kind of emblem.
Yes.
And you put that on there, which is brilliant for branding. Where did you come up with this? When did you come up? Because obviously it's sensible to carry this through what you're doing.
Right, absolutely. Well, you know, my interest in open source hardware started with Arduino, because Arduino, as you probably know, and a lot of viewers probably know, is that it's open source hardware. So all the effort that the developers put into making the board is all available to the public. So you can literally get the design files, you can copy them, straight up copy them, and then make your own board. Now, the Arduino name is copyrighted and trademarked, so you can't just, if you take that Arduino symbol, their branding, that's clearly illegal, that'd be a violation of trademark.
Yeah.
But they provide all of the files and stuff to actually make it. And so so that really got me interested in open source hardware. And as you look out there, there's so many people doing awesome things with open source hardware. And that's kind of why I went with the Open Source Hardware Group. Because because Arduino really helped me out so much, just kind of learning digital electronics and stuff like that. So
Brilliant.
It's kind of why I went down that path.
So now we're going to have a look at the insides.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and Martin has a knife problem. I just asked if he had a knife, and he had like 40 knives in a drawer. So keep that in mind if you ever come to Martin's house. Don't make him upset. All right, so it's just a piece of cardstock, and I just taped it.
So simple.
Yeah, and you know, that's really it. So, I mean, this is, you know, your regular, you think of your breadboard circuit, but the Arduino fits nicely on kind of that standard breadboard size.
Yes.
And so I was able to design these enclosures.
So simple, but so effective. Right, so besides that, I wanted to ask you about your robotic platform, because how did you get into that? What's it called again? It's a DR?
It's a DF robot. And the specific one I think you're talking about is the DF Robot Pirate.
Yes.
So DF Robot is a company that makes a lot of stuff for like hobby robotics type stuff.
Okay.
And I use, you know, I kind of use the word hobby lightly, because people do amazing things. You know, it might be called hobby, but man, the stuff that people do is, I think, very professional in many cases. But so it's a company, they make robotics stuff. And so they had a really common platform called the Pirate. It's like a four-wheel drive, and I'd used a different version of it, of their product before. I made this little robot that you could connect your cell phone up to, and it would kind of like, you can control the movement of it through another computer with the cell phone and stuff.
Wow.
And it was kind of fun, but it was really basically pretty easy to do. And so I thought, well, you know what, maybe people would be interested in having a series on this one of their...
Brilliant.
Yeah, so it's,
and that's, okay, so that's a perfect demonstration of where you're combining, obviously, the programming skills and the hardware and the electronics. Now, I know you mentioned the programming side of it previously, but you didn't quite explain the electronics side of it. Where did your electronics background come for all this?
I'm like a self-learned kind of guy, but I think it's hard not to be interested in electronics in this day of age, because we're just surrounded by it. It's just so, there's so much cool stuff out there. But it wasn't until, 10, 15 years ago, somewhere in there, I had a Honda Accord. I had like a 93 Honda Accord that I was driving around.
Okay.
And it was the kind of, had those, I don't know if they had these in South Africa or not, but it had automatic seatbelts, which were just miserable. So you close the door and the seatbelt.
Okay, not in South Africa.
Yeah,
it's American.
Anyway, right. Thank goodness they got rid of those things. Anyway, so... The car was great because, you know, everybody's like, oh, Honda, it's going to last forever kind of thing. Well, it started having these power issues. It wouldn't shift correctly. And I thought, oh, man, I don't want to have to get rid of this car. So I started Googling, like, you know, what was going on. And it turned out to be the transmission computer in the vehicle had a very specific problem that was messed up. And I started getting on forums, and it was actually a resistor and a capacitor on the board that would burn out. And if you could fix those two things, you could you'd repair your vehicle. And so I thought, no way, right? So I followed the threads, and they weren't the best threads, but they were pretty well documented. And I pulled this transmission computer out into the time, and then I looked at the circuit board. And at the time, I didn't even know how to solder. Didn't even know how to solder.
Okay.
Now I am a welder, so I knew how to weld. So it wasn't too far off from soldering. But it was just like they said. There was a electrolytic capacitor that had blown, and then there was a resistor that had burned out. And so I bought the replacement parts from Radio Shack, and I had my neighbor help me solder the things on there. And we took the car for a test drive, and like for the first 2 miles, it was driving great. And I thought, oh my gosh, two little components had such an impact on this bigger picture.
Yeah.
And just that alone, just like, man, this is so amazing that this could happen. And that really sparked my interest in electronics. Now, past the second mile, it started smoking because we put the electrolytic capacitor on a reverse polarity. So I had to go buy another capacitor. We did it right. And you know what? The car worked for years after that.
Good.
No issues. And so that really sparked my interest. And from that point on, I was just like eating it up. I couldn't get enough of it. And so just kind of self-teaching myself.
Classic. And that's good to know, because I think there are a lot of people out there who are intimidated even by the little, and it can be the most simple little thing. It doesn't have to be a big complicated thing, which can basically sort out a big major problem. So that's absolutely brilliant. So from the robotics thing, then I know you've also got, there's another project that you've got in your vehicle.
Yes, yes.
Which you haven't brought down here.
No, I haven't brought it down.
So we're gonna run outside and quickly have a look at that, and you'll explain it.
Let's
cool.
Do it.
Okay, so for fun, we've just run outside to Michael's car.
Michael's man van.
And so now I've never seen this. I'm not sure what it's all about.
So it's just a key magnet case right up here that I stuck to the roof. It's black, it kind of blends in with the bicycle stuff, but inside is it's a Tiny Circuits GPS tracker, and so it's actually three separate Arduino boards.
Hey.
Right, it's an Arduino board and then separate shields or Arduino-esque. And so it's got a processor board.
Yeah.
And then it's got a GPS unit. And then it's got an SD card logger. So it's essentially an SD logger. And then I've got it hooked up to a lithium battery.
Wow.
And then all it does is it logs the my position every second. It samples the GPS, you know.
And all in that little package?
Yeah, all in that little package.
So it does that, and then it saves it to an SD, all the data?
Yeah, it saves it to this little micro SD card. And then... you can download it, and I'll show you the track on Google Earth if
Let's
you want.
Let's go downstairs now. Look.
Okay. Absolutely. Okay. So again, it's called Tiny Circuits is the company that makes these boards, and it's called the Tiny Duino. It's actually got a local guy. I'm from Akron, Ohio. So he's a startup in Akron. He did a Kickstarter, and they got a really great website. What I like about Tiny Circuits is they're always coming up with crazy new shields, which is awesome. In fact, they just blew another Kickstarter out of the water for a tiny screen that can work on this. Anyway, so the baseboard for the platform though is this this development board. It's a Tiny Duino development board, and it's an Arduino Uno.
Huh.
This is an Arduino Uno.
Wow.
Minus some components that you need a shield for. Like with an Arduino, it has a USB cable.
Yep.
Well, this doesn't have a USB port, so there's a shield for a micro USB that you hook up.
Okay.
So you have to add that shield.
Yep.
But otherwise, all the functionality of an Arduino Uno is packed into this little package.
Wow.
That can be run on a coin cell battery, depending on, what you're operating.
Okay.
Okay, so then it's got connectors for different shields, and this is a GPS shield right here. Again, a tiny package, and it just snaps right in like that. This is the SD card shield. And that snaps in, and you can just add shields and shields and shields, and it just stacks up like that. And they've got nice mounting stuff, so you can make it a little more secure and that type of thing. But that's essentially it.
Wow.
So it's a really neat platform to play with. I mean, knowing the guy who designed it and stuff, he's a great guy, and it's just so I enjoy using the platform for that reason, among its ease of use and its just compactability.
Brilliant. So now we're gonna pull the data.
All right, yeah. All right. So what I did is I have a micro SD card adapter. I just plug that into my computer. All right. So I'm gonna open up Google Earth now, and I'm gonna go tools, GPS, and I wanna import from file. I think everything looks right there. Here's our file. Open.
Ah.
All right, so it's importing the tracks on the highway, all that type of stuff. And then, so you can see, you know, I'm driving up 76, and you can zoom in see all this kind of stuff. So you can see, you can get down to the data points here.
My goodness. And you can obviously go and specify the interval, how many data points that you want along the route, or can you?
You know, you can, yes. I didn't, and actually what's great, and you know, this kind of highlights one of the great things about Arduino, is that there's such a huge existing code base out there. So people that are doing great things. And so all I did was take an existing program that Tiny Circuits had developed.
Yeah.
This was actually for a cat tracker. It was it was featured in Make magazine. I don't know if you've heard of Make.
Yes, yeah.
It was featured in Make magazine as a cat tracker. He had to put a collar on his cat and, you know, saw what his cat was up to during the day, which is pretty funny.
So I took it and I
put it in a key case, stuck it on my van, and so he had it set up so it tracked every second, and that's actually how that GPS module he has set up. But yeah, you can definitely get in there and change stuff up. But you know, that's one of the huge advantages of Arduino, is there's so many people working with it that it's not too hard to use.
And your only limitation is your own imagination. You
yes.
can just take it where you want.
Yeah.
Yeah. That is absolutely classic. Right, so that's brilliant. So before we end off, the one thing I wanted to highlight as well is that I've just gone and viewed your that tutorial where you go through the robot and you go, and the one thing that's perfect where you fill in the gaps, like you say, you've got an instruction sheet, instruction manual, perhaps in Chinese, and they've gone and left out like some critical steps which would frustrate a beginner no end in terms of building and getting this little robotic platform together. Silly things like explaining what the tools and having jars for sorting the nuts and bolts, all those things. So I can highly recommend, if you certainly want to get right from the beginning started, understand all the bits and pieces, brilliant videos, well put together, hats off to you, because I think you've done a brilliant job. You certainly do, in terms of production and what you do, far better than what I do. But anyway, just briefly tell us, where is your website? Where can people go to if they want to have a look at your videos and your courses?
All right, so the website is at opensourcehardwaregroup.com.
Okay.
So opensourcehardwaregroup.com is the website. I've got a lot of the videos posted there. I've got tutorials posted there, videos, and you can actually sign up for a free course. And it's kind of the first part of the paid course series.
Okay.
And so it really gives you a sample of how I teach and, you know, kind of the stuff I go through, gives them an idea of the quality of the videos. And because, you know, there's a lot of people providing stuff out there, and I think it's important to try to find somebody who resonate well
yeah.
with, you know? And so it, you know, gives people the opportunity to kind of check that out before they make a purchase type thing.
Brilliant. And then what I'll do is, below this video, everyone, I'll put links to the websites, to your YouTube channel and your main website,
right.
and to the course, so that'll be brilliant.
Right.
Michael, you're a good man. I really appreciate your time. Thanks right. very much.
Thank you, Martin.
Done.
It's been awesome.